Hello everyone, so today we will be designing a truss which will look similar to this truss. So in ABAQUS, what we need to do here is we need to design a 2D geometry. We need to assign it a section which will be a truss section, then we'll need to assign it a mesh element which is a truss mesh element, and then we'll apply the desired load and then we'll submit it for the analysis. And we will look at the mesh convergence analysis in the later videos. So we'll first start modeling. So we'll create a model, we'll call it truss 2D and click on OK with everything defaults. So we'll start creating a part. So we'll call it truss and it will be a 2D part, it will be a wire. And we'll make an average size of 50 so that we'll not stress grid too much. Yeah, so we have a plain sheet now. So I have the dimensions with me. So I will be drawing first one 8 meter comma 0 line. That will be a 8 meter line here, this 8 meter line. So to be clear about the dimension, and now what we'll do is we'll just copy this and keep moving it. So start point will be this and end point will be this, so we have just doubled it. Now we'll draw one more line which will be of 4 meter length, so it's 4 meter. Now what we'll do is we'll again move this line, but we'll copy this time. So we'll move with copying, so original instances will always be there. Now what we'll do is we'll again copy another position part. I'll just recopy it and paste it here. After we'll redo the same procedure to create the horizontal elements of the truss. Click on done, move it here. So on this side is complete. Now we have two of this truss elements. So now we'll move, click on done, this point will go here. So it is a symmetric truss as shown in the figure. So I will just draw and the dimensions are shown here. So now again, we need to move the last part from here to here. So all the horizontal members are complete. Now what we'll do is we'll draw one vertical member. So we'll draw that independently, an 8 meter long vertical member, which is 8. And now we will move it to the center. So we have the vertical members. Now we will join the geometry, this to this. Now the other parts which are needed to be joined are so we'll apply a little bit of tricks. We need to go a little higher up here, and then what we'll do is we'll go straight, and then we'll go down on the 8 centimeter marks. In this case it's 8 meter, and we'll do this. So what we'll have here is we'll just remove the unnecessary lines now by trimming them. So now you can see that we have this center point of the edge. Now we'll just join that with the center of the truss like this, and our central part of the truss is complete. Now what we are going to do here is that this part is done. Now what we will be doing is we'll create one more vertical line, and then we'll stretch it. Instead of stretching it we'll create one more vertical line like this. So we have got the center point of the remaining slant element. So what we are going to do here is we'll just reconnect it like this and like this. So our truss is done. Now this part was not necessary, so does this. So this is the this is our truss. Click on cancel, click on done, and our geometry is complete. We'll just check it out again in the truss section. So in truss you can see this part is same. So this we are going in the, so everything else is like very basic. So we need to assign the property of this truss. First of all, we'll create an element and we'll create a material and call it steel, because sorry for my spelling, steel. Anyway, we don't require any density, we'll just provide an elastic modulus of steel, which is 210 gigapascal, that is 10 to the power 9 pascal, and a Poisson's ratio of 0.3. That's done. Now we'll erase the density. Generally we don't require any density in static analysis, so we don't need that, and it's done. So we dismiss this. Now we'll create a section. So here what we require is we have to go to beam section, and there are these two sections, beam and truss. What people generally do is that they select beam sections, but truss doesn't have beams. Truss elements are totally different. They do not take any shear stress. They only take compression and they only take tension. No bending moment, so they do not bend. That's what the basic principle of truss is. We are going to select a truss element and we're going to continue. This is section 1. The material is steel. We'll provide a cross section of 0.3 by 0.3. That means 0.3 by 0.3 square will be 0.09 meter square of cross section. And we'll click on OK. So we have our section 1, which is of truss, and we'll dismiss this. Now we'll assign this section to our truss. We'll be creating this. Now I'll select all the truss, because the whole truss will be made out of same member. You can create different member for different cross sections and different kind of materials for different truss elements. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to make it out of a steel which has same cross section throughout. Section 1, which we just created, click on OK. So it's done. Now you can see it's green, so properties are defined. And now, whenever we assign a truss, we don't require anything else like a composite layup and beam profile orientation. So, if we go with this another section which has beam, so we might require a cross section and profile orientation and everything, but in this case we'll just move on, and in the assembly we'll just move this truss and click on OK. So we have created our part and moved it to assembly. Now we'll go to step. We'll create a basic step, static general, nothing much fancy, everything default, and click on OK. Dismiss. Interaction. For interaction we don't require anything, so let's just move on it. Let's just go to the load. In load module we need to define our loads. So in my truss I have three concentrated loads, because we can only apply concentrated loads at the nodes in the truss. That's how trusses work. In assignment problems you might have seen that you can apply like line load or surface load on the truss. That is not how they work. That's not the principle. So we'll just start applying loads on the nodes. So first load will come around I think this node, yeah, and we'll click on done. So this force, it's a CF1, that means x direction, CF2, that means y direction. So CF1 is 0, CF2 will be negative because y direction is upwards, positive, so negative will come down. 10 kilonewton load, so that means 10,000 newtons. So we have just inserted that and click on OK. And this is the load we have created. Now we'll create one more load. that is concentrated and continue. And now we will select our other what we say other joint to apply the load. Click on that. So this, the joint is central one, however you say it, and the same load 10 kN will be applied to this minus 10 to give it then a downward direction, and click on OK. So these two loads will be enough. We can apply one more load for the analysis anywhere else. So I will just add one more concentrated, I will just create one more concentrated load on one more side node. So that will be this. Click on done. Same 10 kN will be applied downward in downward direction to this node. So we applied our loads. Now we have to define our boundary condition. Boundary conditions basically means that how our truss, which point of truss will be hinged and which point of truss will be pinned. So one point on the left side and one point on the right side, the rightmost and leftmost points will be hinged and pinned respectively, or vice versa. So you do that in initial step. So we'll go with this symmetry and dissymmetry in caster condition and continue. This point will apply the pinned condition, that means it will be hinged. Click on OK. And the other point which will have roller supports, click on continue, and we go to the rightmost point and click on done. So to apply roller support, we need it to have a degree of freedom. We need it to be free to move in x direction. So where you can see u1 is not zero. So wherever you see u1 is not zero, that means asymmetric, where u1 is not zero. Will assume this condition to be true for this and apply this on that point. It's done. I think the loop part is done. Now we'll go to meshing. So the meshing part is one more important aspect, because we need to go to parts first. Now for the meshing, we need to assign it an element type. For the truss, we'll select the whole part and click on done. In truss, we do not assign beam, because beam is, as I already said, it will not represent truss completely. So what we need here is we need truss element T2D2, or you can assign T2D3, anything like that. So T2D2 is very basic, two-noded truss element. So it will only use compression and tension forces, nothing else. Click on OK. So every element has now T2D2 mesh properties. Now we'll assign the seats. So there is a basic method that what you can do is you can just assign like seats to all the edges. But what I'm currently going to do is that I will assign seed to all the edges and click on done. So I'll assign it by numbers. The number of elements in each edge is 4, so I apply. So it's like this. So large edges have 4 elements, 1, 2, 3 and 4. I click on OK, and then I will just divide them into meshed elements. You can see now it's green and it's meshed. It's complete. So I'll just go to a job, and I have several other jobs. So I will just create a new one, or I'll just delete this job and click on create. And I'll call it truss 2D job. Click on continue. Everything else will go as it is default, unless you want something, some other processors. But this analysis will not require all these things to be manipulated. So click on OK and submit. So in 5 or 3 or 2, any time soon, it will give us the results. So we'll look at the results. So our analysis is complete. So you can see it's completed. I think it only took 2 or 3 minutes. So I'll directly go to the results, and in the output database file, you can see that the deformations are like this. But these are just scale parameters, so you can just change the scale to look it not so bad. If you put a uniform scale of 1, then it will show the actual deformations or reserve stresses. So we'll just go to the deformations and downward deformations, that will be u2. u2 means y direction. One first direction is x, two is y, and so on. So u2 is the y direction, and you can see that it's the maximum value is 10 to the power minus 4, and it's here somewhere it says minimum value, but you can see that negative direction is downward, so the maximum value is 10 to the power minus 4, something like it's 0.1 millimeter or something. So it's very less as compared to, like, if you can imagine, the strain will be very less. And what you can do further is you can apply mesh convergence study, and you can like apply different meshes to it. So I'll just go do that. So I'll just go to the assembly, and we have our mesh, we have our truss 2D. We'll just copy this and call it finer, 2D finer. So we'll just refine our mesh. We don't have to do nothing else. We'll just go to the mesh previously. Oh, sorry, we need to switch to the part is truss, because otherwise you can just make the part independent so that you can just do the meshing in assembly, but I do not prefer that. So we'll just go to seed edges and select all of them again. Previously we assigned four elements to four divisions of mesh to each elements like this. Now we can just increase it to 8 or any number. So we'll just delete the previous meshes. Now it looks very dense, so we'll just remesh it. Click on yes. So that's how we do it, 2D finer, and we'll create one more job and put it to work. Truss finer. We'll just rename it according to our convenience, and we'll just submit it again. So now you can see that our analysis, other analysis is also completed. So we'll just go to the results, and in the results we'll see that we were checking the deformations which are downward, so the color is almost the same, and just like our previous ODB file, the deformations are almost same as previous one. But you need to just check this value. It says 1.175 10 to the minus 4 negative, and we'll again check the downward displacements. At the same point, maybe, yeah, it shows the same. So it means that this deformations are converging. So you can just go with more finer sizes and check other quantities. What I generally go for is I check the maximum principal stress. So it comes out to be, you can just check the actual value here, 47222. So you can just check that in the previous mesh, the maximum principal stress, that is the same value. So you don't need to go any further finer. You can just go with the coarsest mesh, which is the this 4 where we seeded for 4 parts, not this one, this one where we seeded for the 4 parts. This will work fine for the analysis, and this will also keep in check your computational time. That's why we do mesh convergence analysis, so to see that how finer the mesh is required to get the results. And after that we do not increase our mesh fineness, we just keep the maximum fineness, coarsest mesh, that will give us the best results. So that's the thing.